Okay, Shabbat Shalom, everybody.
Shabbat Shalom,
Mari. Shabbat Shalom. We apologize for the delay. We're supposed to have been starting at 5:30. We just want to thank everybody for their patience, and we'll be starting tonight's service in exactly 8 minutes. And again, I'm glad that everybody was able to participate as we bring in Pesach tonight. And again, Shabbat Shalom. And we're just going to give you a little entertainment before we get started. I don't own the rights to this song. I want everybody to know that. And out there in Facebook, YouTube land, we don't own the rights to this song here. So just hang tight for about 5 more minutes and we'll go ahead and get today's lesson started. Shalom, shalom. So we can hope to speak about
you want to.
Shall I go sit with you?
I don't know. I guess so. Whenever he comes through.
You got what? Kathy.
Huh?
Cut your Bluetooth off.
I did.
You did? Uh-huh. Did you cut off my phone?
The name is what? This is under.
It's.
hold on, let me put it back on that. So,
it's SRS-XB43.
Yes.
What's the number?
No.
You see it?
So I'm going to make you
just
make a
solid
one.
DirectDL Fire TV.
No, what, is it, what did it say?
DirectDL Fire TV 8D0.
It'll say JBL. Hold up, let me put this in. Maybe I need to put it in pairing mode or something.
Bluetooth pairing.
Try it now. You see it? Mm-mm. Oh, wait a minute. Okay, there you go.
There's.
Switch other, see what happens.
Netgear. Hold up. Start at all at 6 o'clock.
This is an apple.
Mm-hmm.
Just came right up.
Well, we good. We'll go ahead and get everything started here.
Yeah. You know, you was always do that.
No, to be vain, to walk in the vanity of your mind. Anything that come up.
One second, Mr. McCall, 1 second here.
Bluetooth pairing.
No, I'll see if we find it.
It's on the phone, but not here.
Oh, it is on your phone? Mm-hmm. Can you put it on here from your phone? Put your phone in.
No, we're good. It's
I know, but just to make sure you got it for future.
Yeah, it's in. Yeah,
okay,
it's
good.
Yeah.
Okay, Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom, everybody.
Shabbat Shalom.
Hallelujah. It's a pleasure seeing everybody here this evening and all the new faces here. We want to thank you for coming and joining us this evening, okay, with our Pesach memorial service. And what we're going to do is go ahead and get services started. I'm going to blow the shofar 7 times. Everybody's going to stand up and face this way, all right, towards Jerusalem, the place where the Father placed his name at. And we're going to have Zabu, okay, the elder, the man of the house, to bring us in with prayer. All right? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Service started, and again, I thank everybody for their appreciation, and we're going to go ahead and do what we do. Hallelujah.
Abba, Lord, we come before your throne just thanking you for allowing us to make it here, Father, on this special set-apart day. Father, you told us to remember the day you brought us out of Mizraim, Father, and Father, we did not forget. It's been passed down for many years, Father. We did not forget. Some of us, Father, went into other religions and other things, Father, but you brought us back. And so we thank you, Father, for that. We praise you and we magnify you, Father, for what you did then and what you're doing now. And now as we enter into this Melchizedek, Father, Pesach, Father, we ask that you would meet us here. Father, you met us there in old. You led us by clouds and by fire. And now we'll ask you to lead us by your son, Yahusha HaMashiach, Father. We also ask that you will lead us by your set-apart spirit, Father, that we may be able to come unto you whole. We ask that you forgive us of any sins we may have committed against you, Father, that we may come to you righteous. We ask, Father, that you help us to remember that this day, Father, is a day, Father, that when we bow down our head to you, Father, yes, we do it on other days, but this day, Father, you have looked at us and you said, remember. And so, Father, we do just that.
We pray, Father, that you will put the words in the mouth of the Moray, just as you did earlier with Moray Aliyahu, Father. We ask that you now do that with Moray Katsalaba, Father. Yes. And that, Father, you will speak through him a message to us. Open the understandings of our ears, our mind, and our heart that we can receive it, that we can apply it to our lives, Father. Because, Father, if we don't apply it, this is falling to the ground, Father. This is falling to the ground. We will not do that, Father. We ask that you look in upon each and every person in this congregation, that you look in upon each and every person that is under the sound of my voice, that you listen to each and that you hear each and every person, Father, who is on Facebook, Father, that is sitting at home or that is sitting somewhere else worshiping you, Father, and doing this, Father, on their own. We ask that you go directly into their living rooms, bedrooms, prayer closets, whatever it is, Father, and that you would meet them there. We ask that you would lift up a bowed down head, Father, that you would mend a broken heart today, that you would look into those who are in need, Father, and that you would baruch them, Father, just as they are and where they are. We ask that you look in upon all of the elect, Father, that have been scattered to the four corners of this earth, Father. Yea, Father, we are not out of slavery yet, but the day is coming, Father. We are not out of slavery yet, Father, but the day is coming. We look forward to your day, Father, and as we enter into this marriage, this happy time, Father, or this, we prepare ourselves to enter into this marriage, this happy time, we ask, Father, that you would again, Father, receive us, Father. We ask that you would be in the midst of us, Father. So there are two or more gathered in my name, there am I in the midst of them. We ask that you would be here, Father, that you will come here and you will let your spirit move, Father, that you will let it move, Father. In your son, Yahushua HaMashiach's name, we pray, hallelujah.
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 Okay, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, everybody. Once again, let me begin by saying I thank everybody for taking time out of their busy schedule to participate with us, the congregation of Yasharal, as we go into the Ruach HaKodesh and bring out some understanding on the importance of Pesach. But before we begin, we want to make sure that everybody understands the importance of giving all esteem to the Father, Ab Yehor, for his love, his mercy, his kindness, his generosity. I mean, just all the things that the Father has been showing his people, which is the 12 tribes of Israel, and will forever in the Father's debt for all the great things that he's been doing for the nation of Israel. We also want to thank the Father for sending his ultimate love gift, Yahushua HaMashiach, who is that atoning sacrifice for the nation of Israel. So to make sure that we have some clarity with everything here, a lot of times you might hear me use Hebrew terms. So when I say Yahushua HaMashiach, I'm referring to what the world knows as Jesus Christ. Okay, so when I say Yahuwah, okay, I'm referring to as the world commonly know as God. Okay, so we want to make sure that everybody has a good understanding. We want to make sure that everybody's on the same page. And I don't want to lose anybody with anything that I will be saying here tonight here, okay? Okay, one thing that I definitely want to bring to everybody's attention, this is for the congregation of Yasharal and all the congregations that are scattered abroad that are actually doing Pesach. And to those that have already done Pesach, I want to say Shabbat Shalom also to you. We respect any and everybody that's trying to at least observe the Father's festivals. And the festivals are very, very important. But this is the key. This is the kicker right here. Is that it is very important to all congregations that we're punctual on the feast days. Okay? Three times a year, the Father's asking for our attention. Three times a year. We talk about Pesach, Shavuot, and the Feast of Sukkot, which happens in the seventh month, the 15th day. And so we have 364 days to prepare between each of the three festivals. 364 days. 5:30 means 5:30. 6 o'clock means 6:30. Whatever congregation is out there, it is very important that we understand to be punctual. That's going to be one of the main requirements, all right, in order for us to be that acceptable bride. When the Father now sends his Son to redeem his children, the 12 tribes of Israel that is scattered abroad. So let's be a little bit more mindful of the times when schedule has been given out or what time we're supposed to actually get services started. But again, like I brought out earlier, I wanted to make sure that everybody understood the importance of the Mashiach and how he is that atoning sacrifice for the nation of Israel, first and foremost. Now, what I want to do is prove a couple of things, because we talked about the importance of God or the Father Yahuwah and how he sent again his ultimate love gift, Yahusha HaMashiach. And the Mashiach died for a reason. He didn't die in vain. He died for a people that got laws, statutes, and commandments. And their responsibility was to follow the laws, statutes, and commandments. And the nation of Israel collectively as a people broke every single law, statute, and commandment. Every single last one of them. So it is very important for us to understand the redemptive role of the Mashiach, why the Father sent him, and why we are here today. We are here today, every single last one of us, is because we're not obedient to the commandments, the instructions. So let's go to, I'm going to go to the book of Yohanan, or the book of John. All right? We want to prove a couple of things first, to make sure that everybody is understanding exactly what's going on here. And I also want to give special thanks here to our Moray here. Okay, we have Shalak Yahu, and it's always a pleasure to have him here. And he's going to be filling in for our executive Moray, Moray Eliyahu. He done a service a little bit earlier today, and we thank you, Moray, for having service, making sure that we cover both angles here. Make sure that nobody is left without. Okay, we're going to go to the book of Yohanan, and we're going to have our Moray Shalak Yahu to go to the book of John, the 12th chapter, and let's see what we're going to do here. We're going to start at verse 25, and we're going to read down to verse 27. So this is 1 John, just in the book of John, the 12th chapter, verse 25 to, let's do 28. Okay, to 28.
The book of John, Yohanan chapter 12, starting at verse 25. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal.
Okay.
If any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor.
Okay, we're going to stop right there. So we see now prerequisites are given on how we are supposed to now reconnect back to the Father. And understanding again the redemptive role of the Mashiach, who the world commonly know as Jesus. So if any man was to serve me, the me is the Jesus, the Yahusha. If any man was to serve me, let him follow me. So it is very important for us to understand again the redemptive role of the Mashiach and understand what is it that the Mashiach was doing, and we make sure that we follow every single thing that he's doing, because he was not sent in vain. Instructions was given to the nation of Israel, and the Mashiach is that perfect role model. Perfect role model. Read on.
Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I into this hour.
Right. So just to have, I want a little participation here. The Mashiach is saying, for this cause came I into this hour. Why do you believe the Mashiach is saying this here? I read verse 27 again. Now is my soul troubled, And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I into this hour. What is happening now here, where the Mashiach is actually now recognizing his purpose and his goal? What is about to happen at this particular point here? Exactly. The Mashiach is about to be put on the tree for what?
For the sins of Yisrael.
Right, for the sins of the nation of Israel, for the sins of Yisrael. Read on.
Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven, saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again.
Hallelujah. So we see now, I have glorified your name, okay, and I will glorify it again. So we need to now know what was now the role of the Mashiach at position-wise before he came on the earth. He was already deemed the Son of the Father, and I will redeem your name again, because he's now come to accomplish every single thing that was expected of him. And I will glorify it again. And so now we have the Mashiach being given a title that is far more superior than any other angel or messenger in the Bible or in heaven. I will glorify it, or I will esteem it again. Because none of the other messengers came and did what the Mashiach did for the nation of Israel, was to die and resurrect, to bring the bride back into covenant relationship with the groom again. So again, this explains to us now the redemptive role of the Mashiach, and his role again was to bring the bride back into covenant relationship. Let's go to the book of Hebrews 10 and 5. The book of Hebrews, the book of Hebrews 10, verse 5. Let me just catch up with you here. Hebrews 10 and 5. Pay very, very close attention. Know what? Start at 1 down to verse 5.
Hebrews chapter 10, starting at verse 1. For the Lord having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comings thereunto perfect.
Hallelujah.
For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers, once purged, should have had no more conscience of sins.
And that's the operative thing that we should be looking at now. For then would they have not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers, once purged, should have had no more conscience of sins. So we see now something is about to happen now to the Levitical priesthood. Because we had the Levites going into now the high priest actually going into the Holy of Holies one time a year. That's the seventh month and the 10th day of the seventh month. But we now have a high priest that supersedes the Levitical order, once dying, purging and cleansing us from our sins, which now puts us now in a better position than the Levitical order.
Hallelujah.
This is the reason why we say,
that's right,
all esteem to the Father for sending his ultimate love gift, Yahusha HaMashiach, who is that atoning sacrifice for the nation of Yisrael. Hallelujah. Read on.
But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins.
Okay.
Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me.
Right. Hallelujah. And so we see now that the Mashiach knew his role and his purpose. From the very beginning, the absolute very beginning, we see now that a body was prepared to atone for the sins of the nation of Israel. So from the very beginning, there was a salvation plan. And it's very important that we take heed to this salvation plan, because the Mashiach is not coming to die again. It is very important, those of you at the sound of my voice, those of you that are here, to recognize fully, again, the redemptive role of Jesus Yahusha HaMashiach. Let's go to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms 40 and 6. And what I'm going to actually do, I'm going to read that one because it reads a little bit different in the
Septuagint.
In the Septuagint. Absolutely. Hallelujah. So we're going to go to the book of Psalms, the 40th chapter, and we're going to go with the Greek Septuagint. Okay, which is an older version than the Masoretic text that we have. Now we have Dawood, or David, speaking in the Ruach HaKodesh, and he's saying now, I start at verse 5. O sovereign, or master, my Elohim, that has multiplied thy wonderful works, and in thy thoughts there is none who shall be likened to thee. I declare and spoke of them, they exceeded number. Sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body has thou prepared me. Whole burnt offerings and sacrifice for sin thou didst not require. So from the very beginning, in order to keep a positive relationship with the Father, what type of offerings were we supposed to make to the Father?
Adam.
What were they?
No,
no, not from the very beginning. From the very beginning, we were supposed to walk in faith and in obedience. And so there was not supposed to be animals sacrificing to atone for sins. Because if you look at it, you had innocent animals dying on your behalf.
That's something I had to doubt.
Exactly. Now, just take a look at it now, because it got to the point where our people were so presumptuous, where they would know that they're going to commit to sin, and then have the animal now already prepared, okay, commit the sin, and then offer up the animal.
Premeditated sin.
Yeah, premeditated. And we already know what happens even in this jurisdiction of the world society today. Premeditated murder is still murder. And it's even more, the punishment is now even more severe because you thought the whole thing out. Israel, we are really, we have a lot of atoning to do collectively as a people. So let's just make sure that we pay very close attention to what's going on around us. And again, the Mashiach is that atoning sacrifice for the nation of Israel. Before we get started, are there any exaltations? Anybody have anything they would like to share on how the Father has been blessing them throughout the year? Because this is what we call Shana Tov. Okay, the new year started back on Gregorian, March the 21st. And this is now the 14th day of the new year. Anybody have any testimonies they would like to share how the Father has been blessing them these last 364 days? Now the 14th day of the new year.
Right.
But anybody have any testimonies they would like to share?
I have a testimony. I would not really provide a testifying about the greatness of God. We have a premium business.
Okay.
And I give God all the praise and all the glory because in the midst of the pandemic, we were still able to go out.
Uh-huh.
And I see the hands of the Lord so vividly.
week going in, and I'm a breast cancer survivor.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, great, hallelujah.
And I'm also going through an open heart surgery. And I just, you know, my hands shake because just to cheer you guys, exalting God, and the word of God is so alive that it just, you know, moves me. And I thank God for just being here.
Yes.
In the land of the living.
Yes.
Just giving him all praise and all glory. And I don't take it for granted what my Savior has done for me. And just to see my daughter, you know, grow up to be a young lady. And when I went through breast cancer, she was small, and I would look at her, God, don't allow me to die and leave my daughter.
Mm.
I want to see her grow up and get married.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord gave me, you know, grant me my heart desire. And I give, I'm telling you, I give all praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Beautiful, beautiful. Hallelujah.
Yeah, I want to thank the Most High too, because the same thing, like, through all of this, I mean, we had so many people at my job getting COVID. We had one person pass away from it. Mm. And it's just off and on, people been getting it. People been having different symptoms, and I've not had it not once. Not one time. Even being around different passengers, I mean, worked at an international airport, never got it. Never came close, I mean, came close to it, but never was affected with it. It didn't really, my daughter either, you know, I had a newborn right in the midst of all of this, so she never experienced it and things of that nature, so everything was just great, and now my daughter is one, so I just praise the Most High for that, and praise the Most High for everything that he's doing in my family, and with the people that sit under me, so it's, everything has been great. I just bless the Most High for that.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Anybody else?
I'll go.
Okay.
So, literally everything, protection, life, all everything, just being here. But I think the strongest testimony is being here.
Yes,
Trevor knows, like, being here because the Father spoke a word back in August about me transitioning down south here, and honestly, I did not believe it. I knew that he was pushing me to understand the scriptures at a deeper level, and because I feel like sometimes we read as at surface level, and we understand at surface level, so he's like, I need you to understand really who I am, my spirit, my word, and literally the transition, when he spoke that I was moving down to Georgia in April, I'm like, and are you sure it's not December 2021, because I don't got a job?
Right.
But, you know, when he speaks a word, he speaks a word. And he's like, are you going to submit to what I say?
Mm.
Are you going to walk in fear? So once I submitted, literally, I will be moving down here on the 23rd
of April.
And just sitting under Moray and learning more, understanding more about who we really are, but even so, who we are through him.
Right.
So I just give him all the praise.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Welcome, 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 welcome. Anybody else? Listen, I want to personally thank the Father also for all the great things that he's been doing for me. Understanding that every single day that I wake up, he's giving me another opportunity to get it right.
Yes.
Okay, this is a walk like no other walk. It's going to take me and each and every one here to be consistent in the walk. There's going to be trials and tribulations. I mean, trust me. Okay, I've been doing this thing since 1992. There's going to be trials and tribulations. You will be tested. And if you're not tested, how will we know that we are that gold? Gold must be tested. And a lot of times people don't like to be tested, but even the Mashiach was tested. Okay, he was tempted by the adversary for 40 days and showed him all the things of the world. And we see that the Mashiach was able to overcome every single adversity. And that's what I'm looking for, and that's what I want to be at the end of the day.
I want to be able to accomplish and walk through every single adversity. I want to thank the Father for just giving me peace in my life, like for the last 2 years. I mean, I've been going through some stuff, but I'm still here standing. I mean, the new addition to my life, the peace and shalom that I now have, I'm just so thankful for just everything that the Father's been doing for me. I'm forever in his debt, and I truly understand that if I was to live 100 times over, I would still be in debt. I mean, really. And I understand that I have to stay in this walk. I have to stay in this walk. Because if I don't stay in this walk here, all of those things that I did when I was back into the world, they can now be readdressed on the day of judgment. And so when we look at that word atoning sacrifice, and we know that the Mashiach now is going to be our voice piece, as it tells us in the book of Revelation, the 12th chapter now, and we know that the adversary has a short time left, and he's accusing Israel day and night before the Father. But we have a mediator who's going to act on our behalf and say, listen, you know what? Such and such person now, they were still consistent in Torah, and the Mashiach now is going to speak on our behalf. But we can't turn back, no matter what. And what I've learned in this walk is that I wanted people that I grew up with, that I was around for such a long time, I wanted those people to come with me. But now, having a better understanding of Torah, not everybody that you start off with is going to be able to run the whole race with you. And that can be very, very hurtful. Very hurtful. And I know that. I mean, it can hurt like the dickens. But we see Job. Okay? Job, he did what he had to do. All right? So again, he that endureth unto the end shall be saved. That's the whole key. So don't be afraid of losing anything. I mean, it's going to hurt. And nobody knows it like me. It's going to hurt. But the Father is really expecting us to make sure that we do this thing to the end in order to be that acceptable bride. All right? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Anything else?
I'd just like to piggyback on what you said.
Okay.
Just keep on striving, my brother. What you're doing here. Because like you say, everybody's not gonna follow you.
Nah.
Because everybody's not born to be a leader.
Right.
Okay, who are the Yeshua? Designate to be a leader, that's who's going to be a leader. And, you know, everybody's not going to follow, you know, the good walk or the good path. So, you know, you want to have followers and you want to have leaders.
Right.
And, you know, just keep your faith and continue what you're doing. And God will continue to bless you.
Hey, I appreciate that. I appreciate those words of encouragement. Hallelujah. Okay, Mr. Kai, what we're going to do is go ahead with tonight's lesson. And the first thing that I want everybody to understand with Pesach is that there's many different levels to it, okay? We're going to kind of keep it as simple as possible, but at the same time, we want everybody to understand the deeper meaning behind it. The first thing that I want to bring to everybody's attention, there's a list of things that is needed to be understood or overstood in Torah or Pesach. I want everybody to understand that a salvation plan existed from the very beginning.
Yes, sir.
Now, think about that. There was a salvation plan put into place for everybody that's here tonight. The Father wants everybody here tonight to make it to that great wedding. Everybody here. All Israel. The invite is for everybody. We're going to go to the book of Genesis, and I'm going to read that one there. We go to the book of Genesis, the first chapter, and we all know this here. I'm going to start at chapter 1, verse 14. Genesis, the first chapter, verse 14. And Elohim said, let there be lights in the firmament. All right, lights in the firmament of the heavens, or Shamayim, to divide the day from the night, and let now these lights now that's in the firmament, let them be for signs okay, and seasons. When we look at that word seasons, now it's the Strong's number 4150, and those seasons now was talking about the Moeds, the Moedims. And these Moedims, okay, they were set up from the very beginning because the Father knew what would happen to the nation of Israel later on, okay? We saw a lot of great things that the Father did for the nation of Israel. But understanding the hearts of the people and that the Father loved us so much, even in your wickedness, think about that. Even in your wickedness, I'm going to still give you an opportunity to shuv. S-H-U-V, which means now to return. Teshuva means to repent. Mm-hmm. And the word shuv means to return. Listen to this real closely now. From Genesis to Revelation, this is talking about a wedding. A love that the groom has for his bride. And I love her so much. But understanding the weakness of her heart, what I'm going to do, I'm going to give you the opportunity to submit. Mm-hmm. That's going to be the key thing. The bride has to submit. When she submits, she's given now the opportunity to come back into covenant relationship with the groom. But it's going to take now your undivided attention, your full cooperation, full submission, and then I can receive you back as my bride. No exceptions. No exceptions. But the thing here now, Moray, is that we have the bride today. She'll say, I'll return, but I want to give you conditions. You committed the fault by breaking the laws, statutes, and commandments. But whenever you find yourself in a situation in your regular marriages or the higher marriage, which is supposed to be now a reflection on how we interact in our personal relationship with our wives, I'm here to tell you, Torah means instructions. That's right. Everybody must follow the instructions. And there will be no compromising. Has to be followed. For we have the Father now, the creator of heaven and earth, the master designer, yeah, the master mathematician, the creator of every single thing, the one who's responsible now for you breathing, for you now waking up in a sane mind and looking at all the things that the Father did for the nation of Israel, bringing her out of Egypt. How dare the bride say, well, I'll come back, but it has to be under my terms and conditions. That's a wicked woman. When I say a wicked woman, I'm talking about the nation of Israel. Mm-hmm. Can anyone name the seven festivals, the salvation plan that was set up from the very beginning? Because the menorah, everybody's familiar with the menorah? Mm-hmm. Okay, where are you coming from, Jersey? Okay, hallelujah. So we got Jersey in the house. I'm from Jersey. Jalak's from Jersey. You're from Jersey. So anybody know the seven plans of salvation that the Father has for the nation of Israel? Write them down.
Pesach.
Okay, first one is Pesach.
Then the Feast of Unleavened Bread.
Okay, we have Unleavened Bread.
First Fruits.
Okay, we have First Fruits on the way to the Sheaf Offering. First Fruits. Shavuot. And this, okay, I'll go ahead. Shavuot, number five.
Kippur.
Teruah.
Oh, Teruah.
Six. Yom Kippur. Some people sell the two peas. And number seven.
Oh, Sukkot.
Sukkot. Sukkot or Sukkot. Now, what's important about this salvation plan is that three times a year, all males is supposed to report to Jerusalem and observe these three festivals here. This is the first festival of the year. These three almost like encompass one another. Mm-hmm. Then you have Shavuot. Shavuot is so important. Or Passover. It's not Passover, Pentecost. Pentecost. Anybody, except for you, Morey, anybody know why Shavuot is so important? Or what happened at Shavuot? What happened at the very first Shavuot in the wilderness? What took place?
Moses?
Right, a Nesuim or a marriage. A marriage took place. And so what I'm trying to share with everybody is that this all, from Genesis to Revelation, is about a wedding. And the Father now wants to have a relationship with his bride. And not just any old, like I always say, any old mediocre, regular relationship. The Father wants to have an intimate relationship with his bride. Then after this, now we have Shavuot, then we have Yom Teruah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Sukkot. But I just wanted to share with everybody, when you go to the book of Genesis, the first chapter, verse 14, and again, you look at that word season, S-E-A-S-O-N, you have the word Moed, or Moedim. It's a strong number, I think it was 4150, and this is what it's talking about.
Appointments.
Oh, and appointments, right, appointments. Appointed times. So again, I just want everybody to understand the importance of the salvation plan and how the Mashiach can be seen in each and every one of these appointments, these moedims that the Father has set up from the very beginning. Now, Passover. That can be found in the book of Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verse 4 through 8. The Feast of Unleavened Bread, Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verse 6. First fruits, or the waving of the sheaf offering. All of this now are prophetic shadow pictures of the Mashiach. And again, the reason why I say prophetic shadow pictures, and the word shadow is that when you see something in a shadow, you don't see the actual thing.
Right.
Okay? So it's a prophetic shadow picture. And as things come into fruition, as we go further and further into time, it actually now comes to a point where you can see the Mashiach from Genesis all the way to Revelation. I'm here to share with everybody that every single chapter from the book of Genesis all the way to Revelation, you will never find one chapter where it's not talking about the 12 tribes of Israel. Not one. But what's so amazing about the whole thing now is that, not to make mock or fun of any other religion, that's not what we're trying to do here. But it amazes me that when we have other denominations, Christians, Baptists, Lutheran, whatever, they read the same book, but they can't see Israel in any of the chapters. And so we say now that blindness has happened in part to Israel, it has really happened.
It's just the Arios and replacement theology.
Replacement theology, exactly. Where everybody is included with everything, where the Father no longer makes a distinction with anything. Let's go to our good brother Solomon, Deuteronomy 14 and 2, and we'll have Jacob James to do Deuteronomy 7 and 6. I want to show how personal this relationship is that the Father is trying to have with the nation of Israel. a personal relationship, an intimate relationship, and the Father's not going to have it any other way. Is there anybody here that's married, that's been married, or whatever the case like that might have been? Pray for you. Nobody's gotten divorced. It happens. It happens, okay, and unfortunately. But I just wanted to share is that every relationship, usually, because times are changing, is that you want an intimate relationship with your spouse. You want to be able to connect on all cylinders, on all levels. You want to be in akkad,
yes.
Okay, which means oneness. You want to have the same agenda, going towards the same direction, all right? This is very important. And so the Mashiach and the Father also wants the same thing. He wants everybody now to go in the same direction. That's what we call a marriage. Okay, so let's go to Deuteronomy 7-6. We have our good brother Shlomo Solomon to read that for us, please.
Deuteronomy 7-6.
Huh? Yes.
Okay. I have Deuteronomy 7.
Oh, 14. And 14 you get 14 and 2 then. 14 and 2. Deuteronomy 14 and 2, and we'll do 7-6.
Okay. You want me to read 7-6?
Yes, Solomon, you can read that first, please.
Deuteronomy 14 and 2. For thou art a set apart people unto Yahuwah the Elohim, and Yahuwah hath chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself above all the nations that are upon the earth.
What does that mean? I mean, does it really take any
explanation? It means
what it says. I mean, where do you go from there? And what I found interesting now was that the Father called us a holy people, a set apart people. A people that's supposed to now show forth his esteem.
Yeah.
Watch this now. It's the bride's responsibility to show forth the groom's esteem.
Oh, isn't that the other way?
There's no role reversal here. No role reversal. Everybody has a role and a position. And nobody loses out. Because it benefits everybody in the end. Israel's responsibility was to be, okay, a righteous people on the earth, setting forth rules and regulations on how everybody else is supposed to walk. Mm-hmm. So if you got technical with this, when the Mashiach came, the world was in darkness. The Father chose a nation, the nation of Israel. And being that the world is in darkness, the world is supposed to be looking at Israel to be their prime example, to be that light of the world, to be the salt of the earth. You were given that responsibility. But watch this. Even in your wickedness, you're still looked up to. And there is nobody, okay, more wicked than an Israelite. And the reason why, because you set the stage for everything. The way that you dress, even if you want to dress half naked up and down the streets, the other nations are going to follow you because you were called for a special calling and they know who you are. So even in your foolishness, so how much more in your righteousness they will follow you? Because the earth now is waiting for the true sons and daughters of the Father to stand up and take their rightful place. You are the kings and queens of all of this here. There you go. You're up. You're up.
Deuteronomy 7, verse 6. For thou art set apart people unto Yahuwah thy Elohim. Yahuwah thy Elohim hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
Above all the people that's on the planet earth, the Father chose the nation of Israel. You are a special people, and what we call a segula, a set apart, precious people. And when you look at the word segula, it means something that you treasure, something that you honor. It's like when you go to, you have like a special cabinet, and you keep all your fine silverware, your fine plates, your crystals, and all those things there. And this is what Israel is. You're the gold. You're the diamond. You're the apple of the Father's eye. And being that we're the apple of the Father's eye, it is about time that each and every one of us walk accordingly. Mm-mm-mm. All right. Shavuot can be found in the book of Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verse 16. Again, Shavuot. Pentecost can be found in Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verse 16. The Feast of Trumpets can be found in Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verse 24. Yom Kippur, or the Day of Atonement. We talked about the Day of Atonement, where we now have a transferring of power from the high priest that came from the Levitical priesthood to now we have a high priest who went into the Holy of Holies now and made that atoning sacrifice for the nation of Israel one time.
One time.
One time. All right, hallelujah. Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verses 26 to 32, explains the Day of Atonement. And the last festival, the Feast of Sukkot, you'll be able to find that in the book of Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, verse 24. These festivals are extremely important. It is mandatory that we know and understand each and one of these festivals, yes, the same way that you're able to understand the whole album of Beyonce. Okay? You're able to understand and read every single lyric to her song, and that won't bring you to salvation. But these festivals that we're talking about here, Passover, okay, we have the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the waving of the sheaf offering, we have Shavuot, Yom Teruah, we have Yom Kippur, and we have the Feast of Sukkot. Those festivals are mandatory.
Yes.
That we understand those things. But we forgot one. What was the very first festival that the Father told us to always remember?
Shabbat.
Hallelujah. Shabbat. Hallelujah. Shabbat. We must make sure that we understand, okay, the set-apart festival that the Father set up from the very beginning.
That's right.
Okay, so the theme that we're going to be doing tonight, we're going to be going into on the book of Exodus, the 12th chapter, verse 1. But, Morey, what I want you to do, please, for me, is to go to the book of Exodus, and we're going to read verses 1 through 8, but let me catch up with you.
Okay.
Let me pull it up. The book of Exodus. And Morey, if you need to elaborate or bring out anything, please, by all means, do what the Father has given you to do.
Yes, sir.
Which means to elaborate. And if anything needs to be brought clearer, go ahead and do what you do.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Shemot, or Exodus chapter 12, starting at verse 1. And Yahuwah spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months, and it shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb.
Okay, hold on one quick second. My fault. Exodus, the 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 8. Is that where everybody was at? Oh, I just said it. I mean,
you're 12.
Oh, no. That's going to be the theme. Exodus, the 12th chapter, is going to be the theme. But I want everybody to please go to Exodus, the 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 8. Okay.
All right, let's do this again.
Okay.
Exodus chapter 3, yes, verses 1 through 8.
I said, you must have had the master's edition. I'm looking, and I said, something's going wrong here. So, we are both now going in the same direction. Okay? Exodus, the third chapter, three and one.
It says, now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law.
Hallelujah.
The priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahuwah appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burnt with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Hallelujah.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when Yahuwah saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. Mm-hmm. And he said, Draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is set apart ground. Mm-hmm. Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father.
Right, I'm the Elohim of your father, mm-hmm. personal, of your father, read on.
The Elohim of Abraham, mm-hmm. the Elohim of Isaac,
okay.
and the Elohim of Jacob. Mm-hmm. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Okay.
And Yahuwah said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters. Wow. For I know their sorrows.
Right. So when we begin to look at our prophetic shadow picture, so just to bring everybody up to speed here, what's going on here now is that Moses is going to be sent to deliver his people from out of bondage. And we have now Moses being a shepherd, leading the shepherd of Jethro, and he's going down to a set apart mountain, and he's going to be given now instructions on how to deliver this people. But it makes mention now that Moses saw now a bush, okay? And the bush was, he saw, let me just read, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. There's a lot of different ways that we can look at what's going on here. Looking at and understanding what Moses was about to do, that fire always represents strength and authority. Mm-hmm. That fire now is going to be that light, that inspiration, and that voice is what it's going to be. And now this fire now was around this bush, okay, but the bush was not consumed. And we see now that there was a people now that was in captivity, but they were being kept alive, okay, by this burning flame, but the bush was not consumed. And this bush now is going to represent a people, which is the nation of Israel. And the reason why I'm using this fire as representing the Mashiach now, because when you go to the book of Genesis now, the 15th chapter, it talks about a smoking furnace, okay, and this burning lamp going between the pieces. We see also now the smoking furnace, no, actually a cloud by day, and this lamp of fire by night, walking with Israel for 40 years in the wilderness. When we look at the Holy of Holies now, we also see now this smoke, mm-hmm. okay, hovering over the mercy seat. And this mercy now was given to the nation of Israel because the high priest now is actually going into now the Holy of Holies one time a year. And so now, but this bush now was not consumed. When Israel was in Egypt, Israel was not consumed.
That's right.
Even in these last days here, this bush is in Egypt and is not being consumed. But there's coming a time when this bush needs to be delivered out of captivity. Read on.
And I want to add, if you don't mind.
Sure.
It goes back to what Moray was saying about us being a chosen people and us being a vessel of honor. Not only that, coming forth from the fire as gold. In affliction, we see, we can see this in our daily lives, that affliction always brings the best qualities in you. It brings forth character. And in the same way, affliction brought Israel to the place that they needed to become, to be a nation of people, to receive from the Most High what they needed. And he used someone like Moses, whose name means to draw out, to draw this out of his people. So we're going to see, like Moray was saying, this prophetic picture of the Father constantly extending his hand in the midst of affliction and drawing his people out. And every time he draws his people out, they come out better and better. So,
hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 8, please.
Verse 8. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Hallelujah. I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. Read on.
And to bring them out of that land and unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites.
Right, hallelujah. The word that we want to look at is the word deliver. I've come down to deliver the children of Israel. It's the Strong's number 5337, and the Hebrew word is actually Nasal, N-A-T-S-A-L. It means to snatch away, to deliver, to rescue, to save, to tear oneself away, to deliver oneself. So I just wanted to bring that out, is that there's going to come a time where the Father is going to deliver his people from out of the lands of their captivity. And I'll leave it there for right now.
Can I answer that?
Yes.
Because the word that's all, if you look at it from the ancient, it comes from I believe, null, which deal with the noon and the lamed, mm-hmm. and it means as a shaking. So Natsal right. means to be delivered through a shaking or by a shaking. So in the midst of your deliverance, there's going to be a shifting or a shaking taking place. And that shaking is congruent with affliction.
Absolutely, it is. And there's going to be a lot of sifting.
That's a good word.
There's going to be a lot of sifting because not everybody's going to be able to make it.
That's right.
Only the best is going to be able to make it. And those of us that are, because I remember my grandmother, she used to make homemade biscuits. And she would put all of this flour into a sifter. And she was shaking. Okay. And the good flour, obviously, that will fall down into the bucket or to the pan. But the hard crumbles or whatever might have been, will stay at the top. Okay. Because it wasn't able to go through the straight and narrow. Mm, okay.
That's a good one. Right
it couldn't go through there. And so my grandmother, she just couldn't use that. So let's go to the book of Romans, the 7th chapter. Romans, the 7th chapter, Moray, if you can go 7 and 24.
Okay.
Let me pull it up also. Romans 7, 24. Romans 7, 24. We're just about into the neck of the woods. Romans 7, 24. I'm with you.
Romans chapter 7, verse 24. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?
Right. So we have Shaul, or Paul saying, now, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? This death is sin. That's what the whole thing is about, sin and being delivered. And so we see now in the book of Exodus, the 3rd chapter now, we see that Israel now is going to actually now be delivered now from this death situation, but there's a certain type of character and behavior that the bride must have. Versus now what happened at the first Exodus. This second Exodus now is going to make the first Exodus look like child's play. Mm-mm-mm. And that bride has to have her game correct. Mm. There can't be any blemishes on her wedding garment. Absolutely none. The Father is only taking the very best. The very best. Every man, when he marries a woman, wants the very best. Every woman that is married to her husband, she's expecting her man, her ish, to be the very best. And so if both parties are the very best, you can only expect the very best in offspring.
Woo.
Yes.
But on that note, too,
yes, sir.
It's hard to find the best.
Yes, yes.
Only the best.
Yes.
But with God, you know, he give you a chance to make, to follow that path to become, don't know if you're going to become the best.
Right.
You know, but we all have a chance,
mm-hmm.
you know,
you're right.
to mark.
That's right. Absolutely.
And, you know, it depends how far you travel to make that mark. You say only the best going to make it, but I don't know about the best making it.
Yes.
Right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Right? I'm just saying, you're absolutely correct.
That's
my opinion, you know.
And this is the reason why the scripture talks about only a remnant is going to be saved. Yes. Only a remnant. And a remnant now is the lesser part of a whole. So there's going to be more people that, if we get real technical with it, there's going to be more people dying than people actually making it.
Woof.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I mean, so again, this is the reason why we're saying we have every opportunity now. And I believe that each and every one of us is in debt. I begin to look at or hear all the great things that the Father has done for you through breast cancer, open heart surgery, and there's so many things that we have been overcoming. All the things that the Father is sharing with you, it lets me know that we are really in debt.
We owe him our lives.
Absolutely. And that's going to be the whole thing there. Can you walk this thing out to the end? Because not everybody can walk this walk out and actually now lay down your life for your brother.
You have been bought with a price.
Yeah. We've been bought with a price. And so again, when we begin to see the Mashiach, then how we must mimic our lifestyle towards those also now that are following Torah, we're supposed to be now giving up our lives for the cause. And even when we begin to look at, like Moray, your position as Moray, we have Zabu, he's an elder. We have Yekezekiel, his position. All these men here now that are in positions, we have to be very mindful of the positions that we're in. Because when we take on these positions now, it means now that we're willing now to give our lives up for the cause. And even out in our personal lives, we see now in relationships now where the woman, she's always sacrificing her life now every single time that she gets pregnant. Because it becomes a life and death situation. So in order now to bring forth fruit, sometimes something has to die. And being that we see the condition that our people are in today, the question is, are you willing to make that sacrifice so that the next generation can have a good example on how to walk in Torah? Because as we know, there's a lot of dysfunction in the so-called black community. Who's going to make that sacrifice and stick together so that the next generation can see a positive role model where we have both the mother or the father and the mother still inside the relationship? I didn't see that while growing up. Now understanding Torah, I understand now is that it's going to take patience that we must have with one another the same way that the Mashiach had or the Father had patience with us. Because the Father could have gotten rid of us a long time ago. But if it wasn't for the promise that he made with our forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, none of us would be here today. That's the reason why I say we want to make sure that we give all praises and honor to the Father for his love, his patience, and his kindness for the nation of Israel. We are in debt up into our eyeballs and over that. We're drowning in debt. Drowning. Submit to Torah. I would tell everybody. Let's go to Exodus the 12th chapter. Let's go ahead and get things rocking and rolling, okay? Exodus the 12th chapter. And this is not going to be long. We're almost done. Exodus the 12th chapter. Moray, we're going to have you to break ground on this. But kind of stop at each, at the end of each
period.
Again, you got the master's edition, you got the periods at yours. So, but yeah, at the end of each verse, let's kind of stop. Yeah, Exodus 12 chapter. All
right. Shemot, or Exodus chapter 12, starting at verse 1. And Yahuwah spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you.
Okay, then, so this is going to be extremely important the Father is speaking to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt. This month should be the beginning of the month. It's the first month of the year. I'm not going to get too in-depth with it, but the spring brings in the new year.
Right.
Okay? Not January the 1st. So, because we know now that during Passover, there was something that we needed to actually wave before the Father. Anybody know what grain, not do more, but anybody know what grain grows first in Israel?
Wheat. Barley.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay.
It's always the second person.
Yeah. Oh, man. Exactly. And so again, barley is one of the first grains that grow in Israel. And so we know that it can't be January, can't be the beginning of the year, because nothing is growing in the heart of the winter.
Right.
It's too cold. And so what we're trying to do is reverse that Western mindset and try to get everybody to understand and look at the scriptures from a Hebraic perspective. The Father is speaking to us in agricultural terms, which should be easy for us to understand, but make sure that we read it from a Hebraic perspective. Speak on.
Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, and the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb.
Right. So, let's do some erasing here. Make sure everybody follows along. We have the beginning of the year. The beginning of the year, we say Shana Tov. Okay. What brings in the new year based upon a Hebraic perspective? All right. There's a big controversy whether it's the moon or whether it's the sun. We went to the book of Genesis, the 14th chapter, and it gave mention of three luminaries. All right. The greatest luminary is the sun. We know that the moon now gets its illumination from the sun, and we have the stars. What we do now to calculate when the new year begins is that we use all three luminaries. But first and foremost, we must make sure that we understand the greater luminary. The greater luminary is the sun. That's the order. Then we have the moon, and then we have the stars. But we're not going to go too far into this. The sun has a cycle of 364 days. The moon has a cycle of 354 days. So there's a discrepancy between these two luminaries by 10 days. The new month, because the word here for moon, for month is the word Kodesh. Is the word Kodesh, and it just means month. The word moon in Hebrew is the word Yerach. All right? So there's a solar cycle, and then there's a lunar cycle. This cycle is first, this is second, this is third, and again, there's even a star constellation that helps us to bring in the new year. And just briefly now, without going too much into it, is that when Israel was in the wilderness, not in the wilderness, but when it was in Egypt at that time, Israel was under the constellation of Aries. It was, no, see, Taurus, but it was Taurus, the bull. It was Taurus. And this is the reason why we... Taurus, something like that. But anyway, the thing now is that when we see Israel in the wilderness, what they was always doing now, they kept building this golden calf. And this golden calf now is actually representing an astrological sign. And so now we have the Father explaining to Moses in Genesis, the 12th chapter, that this is the beginning of the year. When each constellation changes, there's a shift in the luminary calendar. There's a shift, and right now we're under a different constellation, all right? So now, anybody know what constellation that we might be under now?
Aries?
Yeah, we're under, it is Pisces. It's Pisces, isn't it?
It should be Pisces.
It's Pisces now. We're under Pisces now. We're about to move actually to another constellation now. So I just wanted to bring this out where we have a sun count of 364 days in a year. We have a lunar count of 354 days in a year. And this could also be explained. Some say 365 and a quarter. 365 and a quarter days. So read on, because we have now the first month, right? Mm-hmm. Which is the month of the bee, or Nisan. And then it said, what, the 10th day?
It says, the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house.
Okay, so we have the beginning of the year, and then on the 10th day, every man now is supposed to take a lamb. These were the instructions that the Father was given to the nation of Israel when they were in Egypt. All right, so read on here. So we have the selection of the lamb on the 10th day.
And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Mm-hmm. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year.
Right.
Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats.
Now, everybody understands prophetic shadow pictures? How the whole thing works, where everything is actually pointing to the Mashiach? Oh, okay, hallelujah. Is everybody aware that on the 10th day of the first month, we have in the Gospels where the high priest was actually choosing the lambs, and we have the Mashiach coming into Jerusalem on the 10th day, riding on the donkey, and we have the crowd now saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, which is praise the Father. Mm-hmm. And we had now the Pharisees and the Sadducees telling the Mashiach to quiet down your disciples. And when the Mashiach came into Jerusalem on the 10th day, that was actually now the selection now of the Lamb, where we see prophecy unfolding. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about it. Okay. read on. I didn't want to go too far because it'll just take us off in a whole other lesson. But what I'm trying to show now is that everything that is happening in Exodus, the 12th chapter, we see the Mashiach fulfilling those things. It said that the lamb can't have any blemishes. The Mashiach had no blemishes. So in order for this to be the correct, in order for this now to be the perfect sacrifice, the Mashiach has to follow the program to the T. It may mention that the lamb has to be a year old. I did a class on it, but I think I'm going to have to elaborate a little bit more on it. Anybody know how long the Mashiach's ministry was?
33 years.
33 years?
No, 3.5.
Okay. All right.
I'd have been bad in the thousand.
Yeah. The book of John actually shares with us that the Mashiach's ministry was actually exactly 1 year.
1 year. 1 year.
1 year. Because remember now, yeah, we talked about this.
Remember when we made the class?
Yeah, we talked about this. So what happened now was that the Mashiach being that lamb, and the lamb has to be killed, okay, within that year. The lamb can be a year and a half years old, but it can't be 2 years old. So the Mashiach's ministry would have to coincide with 1 year, and what I'll do is I'll just do another class on it. But right now, you pretty much have to take my word for it. Okay. just take the opportunity, you know, when you have your downtime, just read the book of John. There's a chronology on how this whole thing is operating. So we have now the 10th day, the lamb is selected. We have the lamb now can't be more than a year and a half years old. which is describing the Mashiach's ministry. Read on.
And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month.
The 14th day, okay? The 14th day of the same month. Morey Eliyahu did an excellent class on what happened on the 14th. On the 14th, now the Mashiach had his last communion. Okay, I learned a new word, okay, because I haven't been going to no churches. I don't know nothing about church. I knew nothing about communion, anything like that, all right? My walk was from the streets to Israel. There was no middle ground, all right? That's the way that I just learned it. So anyway, we have now, on the 14th, the Mashiach had his last meal with his Talmudim. Anybody know what the last meal that the Mashiach had with his Talmudim, what did it include?
Come on, y'all. Leavened bread. Wine.
Okay, we had leavened bread, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, and what else did they have?
Wine.
The disciples had wine.
Yeah, he didn't have wine.
Uh-huh. Was there anything else? They had eight lambs. Okay, they didn't have lamb, but the lamb was there, mm-hmm.
Yeah,
right?
He was the lamb.
And he was the lamb. And what's interesting now is that the Mashiach told his disciples now that he would not be able to drink or have this wine ceremony with them, but he would have it with them now in the new kingdom. So we have now the Lamb being the Mashiach. The Mashiach was without blemish. But what made the groom leaven is that the groom now is taking on the adulterous sins of the woman.
Yes.
And the woman is the nation of Israel.
That's right.
All right? Because again, the Mashiach has to be that atoning sacrifice. No blemishes. Read on.
And the whole assembly of the congregation of Yasharoah of Israel shall kill it in the evening.
Right. It shall kill the lamb in the evening.
And they shall take up the blood and strike it on the two side posts on the upper door posts of the houses wherein they shall eat it.
Okay. Now, what time is the lamb killed?
Between the evening.
Okay, what time is that?
3 o'clock.
Okay, 3 o'clock. So between the evenings, as we know, 12 o'clock is even. This is now after 12, we have evening. The sun is directly above the horizon. The sun now is below the horizon. So we have now between this even and this evening, between 12 o'clock and 6 o'clock, we have 3 o'clock. This is when the Mashiach gave up the Ruach HaKodesh. Mm-hmm. This is when he gave it up, around 3 o'clock p.m. The Mashiach was put on the tree at the ninth hour, at the third hour. So this would be the third hour, this would be the sixth hour, this would be the ninth hour. There was darkness upon the face of the earth now, starting from this point right here, mm-hmm. until this point right here, for 3 hours, basically about 3 hours. Morey earlier made mention that the first curtain was rent, okay, and it happened around this time right here. Mm-hmm. But what's interesting now is that, remember, an eclipse, but when you check the history now is that their argument is that there was no eclipse 3,000 years ago, even 4,000 years ago, during the time of the Mashiach's ministry. But there's an argument that something actually blocked the sun, and we just leave it there. My argument now is going to be now that there was a veil over the sun, okay, which caused this eclipse from the sixth hour to the ninth hour. When this veil was lifted, okay, there was now light back on the earth.
The earth.
This pivotal point is extremely important, is because when Moses goes up to the top of the mount, okay, he illuminated. Whenever you're in the presence of the Father, you're now a new being, you're illuminated. Mm-hmm. Remember when the Mashiach took Peter, was it Peter, James, and John? Was it Peter, James, and John? Mm-hmm. He took them up to the top of the mountain and he transfigured before them. Mm-hmm. And he became illuminated.
Right.
Now, we see now Moses now being illuminated. When he came off the mount, he had to put a veil on his face. He put the veil on his face now because now at that present time, Israel was not able now to receive, as they say, the full glory or the full picture of Torah. He just came off the mount. So a veil was put on his face. And this is the reason why we read in the book of Corinthians, it says that that veil that was on Moses' face now is done away in the Mashiach. Mm-hmm. So now when we have now this veil happening at the sixth hour to the ninth hour, this veil now is taken away. And we see this veil being taken away when the first curtain is rent. When the first curtain is rent now, we see that the priesthood, that there has been a change in the priesthood. Mm-hmm. So you can now go into the first part of the temple where you have the showbread on the right-hand side. You have the menorah on the left-hand side. And you have the table of incense. You can see all of that. Mm-hmm. But the Holy of Holies, that curtain is still there. It was still there. And the only one that was privy to going into that curtain now was the Mashiach. That's the reason why Moray brought out today. Who would then now be the rightful person now to actually hold the office and going into the Holy of Holies? Because Caiaphas now had rent his garment. When Caiaphas rent his garment, lets us know now that there was a change in priesthood. So this Passover is extremely important. Extremely important. It's the Father's salvation plan. This salvation plan is so important because when you look at Shavuot, with the Mashiach being put on the tree at the third hour, which is 9 o'clock a.m., when you go to the book of Acts, the second chapter, what time did the Ruach HaKodesh fall on the apostles?
The third hour of the day.
I mean, the third hour, which is
9 o'clock
a.m.
Mm-hmm. That's why they thought
they drunk. Yeah, exactly. It's only 9 o'clock. Nobody's drunk here. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just trying to show now that from Genesis to Revelation, all of the festivals that we see here with the menorah is all a prophetic shadow picture of the Mashiach.
The Mashiach. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Rewind.
It says, and they shall eat the flesh in that night,
uh-huh,
roast with fire,
mm-hmm,
and unleavened bread,
right,
and with bitter herbs they shall eat it.
Okay, so we're going to have lamb, which represents the body. Mm-hmm. But what is the most important, what's the word I'm looking for? What is the most important thing of the lamb? Right, bones can't be broken, but the most important part of the lamb is the blood.
The blood, yeah.
Okay, because we were now being redeemed by the blood of the lamb. Mm-hmm. When the blood was supposed to be put on the two side posts and right underneath the top, and like I've been sharing before, that makes the symbol of this Hebrew letter here, which is the ketz, which means the fence, mm-hmm, or to guard or to protect. So everybody now that had the blood of the doorpost on the inside was protected from the outside. The enclosed garden, mm-hmm, okay, the Gan. In the book of Genesis, the Father placed Adam in an enclosed garden. And Adam was told to protect and guard the garden. Protect and guard the garden from who?
The adversary.
So now, when you see the blood on the doorposts of the houses now, this protects everybody from the inside
from what's going on the outside. So what the Father wants to do with us, he wants to tabernacle on the inside of us to protect us now from everything that's going on the outside.
That's right.
It fits like a hand in a glove. It's just that we must make sure that we look at the scriptures from a Hebraic perspective. Mm-hmm. Read on.
You just got to put the glove on.
That's right.
What verse
are you at? I'm at verse 9. Eat not of it raw,
uh-huh,
nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the pertinence thereof.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 10. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning,
mm-hmm,
and that which remaineth of it until the morning, ye shall burn with fire.
Yes. Hallelujah. So we're giving out the instructions on how to hold Passover. We're not in our land now. Okay, so scriptures has it 3 times a year, all males must report to Jerusalem, but we know that there's an illegal occupants in the land now. All right? Mm-hmm. And we know that the temple was destroyed.
Yes.
Israel didn't get it. All right, when the curtain was rent in two, and watch this now, it wasn't rent from the top down, it was rent from the bottom up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we have a whole lot that's going on here. And to let us know that the Father's not playing, that there's a change in the temple. When the Mashiach died, when you go to the book of Acts, the first chapter, and we have the Mashiach now going back up, mm-hmm, okay, to Shamayim. And we have the messengers say, listen, you know what? The same way that you see this Mashiach going up, he's going to come back down the same way.
Right.
40 years later, mm-hmm, we have the complete destruction of Jerusalem. The temple was completely destroyed. So that's going to be very important. So how do we now reconnect back to the Father? Because the feast days are still here. We still have to keep the calendar count. How do we now keep in contact or have this relationship with the Father? Right, through the Ruach HaKodesh. But what's happening now is that you are that temple.
That's
that the
right.
Father wants to tabernacle inside of.
Yes, hallelujah.
That's what's going on here. Now there's the literal way of looking at the scriptures, and there's the spiritual way of looking at the scriptures. And both of them now do work hand in hand.
That's right.
For 40 years, the Father was trying to now build the temple. But that temple that he was trying to build was you. Sure.
Mm-hmm.
He wants a tabernacle inside of you. Mm-hmm. The Mashiach said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Mm-hmm. Because his disciples said, show us the Father and it sufficeth us. Mm-hmm. So every single time that I look at you, do I see, or do you see now the Ruach in me?
Hmm.
Because you know a tree by the fruit that it bears. Every last one of us must, no exceptions, every last one of us must show forth that Ruach HaKodesh inside of them. That's the only way you can make it. I won't say that, but any other way you'll be behind out. I won't say the other word, but you know, you'll be behind out. Read on.
It says, and thus, verse 11, shall ye eat it with your loins girded,
mm-hmm,
your shoes on your feet,
uh-huh,
and your staff in your hand.
Hallelujah.
And ye shall eat it in haste.
Mm-hmm.
It is Yahuwah's Passover.
Right, hallelujah. How many days are we supposed to eat unleavened bread?
They say 7.
Right, 7 days, 11 bread, right? Now, there's a teaching. I don't have any problems with it, because what we're only doing is that we're, this is a memorial, okay? We're memorizing how the first Passover took place and the rules and regulations behind that, but now we have the Mashiach. And instructions was given that we're not supposed to eat unleavened bread for 7 days. I have no problem with that. Anybody that don't want to eat unleavened bread for 7 days, fine. Hallelujah. Our argument in understanding the festivals and understanding the redemptive role of the Mashiach is that not just 7 days, but you don't want this unleavened,
yes,
this hatred, this malice, this jealousy, oh, yeah, in you from this point going forward.
That's right. For the rest of your life.
Exactly. This is how we're expecting you to walk. Because in this physical bread here, you can eat it for 7 days. And then after that, you can start eating the bread again. But when you walk into Mashiach, the Mashiach said, I'm the bread of life. So if the Mashiach is the bread of life, I'm going to walk like the Mashiach and not have leaven in my life the rest of the walk.
That's right.
Yeah. You see what I'm saying? But again, I'm not going to knock nobody. If you want to keep it that way and you don't want to eat the unleavened bread, okay, so as long as you understand the higher principles behind it.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, be on. Yeah, if you have something.
No, I just said thank you for pointing that out, because what we partake of here is a Melchizedek Passover.
Right.
We do it under the understanding of what Yahushua HaMashiach, through the order of Melchizedek, has fulfilled and has brought forth from what we see him doing with his disciples.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the beauty of it. So we don't take away from what others are observing, what they seen happen in Egypt, but we see the totality of the picture. And
right.
That's what we memorialize. That's what we gravitate to. So let's read. It says, and this shall be unto you. No, sorry. It says, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt.
Anybody know what night the death angels flew over the houses of Israel that had the blood on the doorposts? What night that was? Not used. Shalai, Moray. Anybody know what did? Because what I was trying to do is make sure that everybody was keeping abreast of what was going on. We talked about the first month. We talked about the 10th day. The lamb is killed on the 14th between the two evenings. And then after that, we go into the eating of the lamb with the unleavened bread and the bitter herbs. So understanding how time is reckoned. Do anybody know when the death angels actually flew over the houses of Israel?
13th day.
The 13th? Because the lamb is killed on the 14th.
The lamb is killed on the 14th.
On the 14th. So that's a biblical balance. Right, so it happened to be 15th nighttime. Oh, you say you flew over, you passed over the next week?
That after you did the 13th.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
A day short, early, whatever. Okay, now you got to make sure that we're on time when the conductor is about to leave there.
He comes on the 13th.
You got to make sure. Okay, read on, please.
It says, and I will smite the firstborn in the land of Egypt, mm-hmm. both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment.
Right.
I am Yahuwah. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial. And ye shall keep it a feast to Yahuwah throughout your generations.
Mm.
Ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day ye shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. And in the first day, there shall be a set apart convocation. And in the seventh day, there shall be a set apart convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. And ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread. For in this selfsame day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore ye shall observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever.
Hallelujah.
In the first month of the 14th day of the month at evening, ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses, for whosoever eat of that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Yasharoth, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. Ye shall eat nothing leavened, and all your habitations shall ye eat unleavened bread. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover.
Hallelujah. What verse are you in?
I'm on verse 22 now.
Oh, okay. Yeah, read on down.
Okay. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. For Yahuwah will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he see of the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, Yahuwah will pass over the door and will not suffer to not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you.
Mm-hmm.
And ye shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever. And it shall come to pass when ye be come to the land which Yahuwah will give you, according as he hath promised, that ye shall keep this service. And it shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, what mean ye by this service? That ye shall say, it is the sacrifice of Yahuwah's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. And the people bowed their head and worshiped. And the children of Israel went away and did as Yahuwah had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. Keep going.
Let's have Solomon to pick it up from there.
Verse 29.
And it came to pass that at midnight Yahuwah smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants, and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night, and said, rise up, and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve Yahuwah as ye have said. Also take your flock and your herds, and ye have said, and be gone, and bless me also.
Mm-hmm.
And the Egyptians were urgent upon the people, that they might send them out of the land in haste, for they said, we be all dead men. And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders. And the children of Israel did according to the word of Moses, and they borrowed of the Egyptians jewels and silver, and jewels of gold, and raiment. And Yahuwah gave the people favor in the sight of Egyptians, so that they lent unto them such things as they required, and they spoiled the Egyptians. And the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 on foot that were men beside children. And a mixed multitude went up also with them, in flocks, in herds, even very much cattle. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth of Egypt, out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry. Neither had they prepared for themselves any victuals. Now, the sojourning of the children of Israel, who dwelt in Egypt, was 430 years. And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day that it came to pass, that all the hosts of Yahuwah went out from the land of Egypt. It is a night to be much observed unto Yahuwah, for bringing them out of the land of Egypt. This is the night of Yahuwah to be observed of all the children of Israel in their generations. And Yahuwah said unto Moses and Aaron, this is the ordinance of the Passover.
Okay.
There shall no stranger eat thereof, but every man's servant that is bought for money, when thou hast circumcised him, thou shalt eat thereof. A foreigner and a hired servant shall not eat thereof.
Okay. Verse 44, it says, but every man's servant that is bought for money, when thou hast circumcised him, shall he eat thereof. And then it says in verse 45, a foreigner and a hired servant should not eat thereof.
Hmm.
This is the question. Every man's servant that is bought for money, when he has been circumcised, he shall eat thereof. Who is this servant here? Because what's happening is I found out a lot of people kind of like mixing up verse 44 with verse 45. Israel can have or hire servants. Verse 45 is not saying the same thing. I'm going to read this here in Hebrew here, all right? Just to show that there's a difference that's going on in verse 44 and 45. I'm not capitalizing on circumcision. That's not what I'm doing. If anybody has the Hebrew version of it, we have Wakahal, Eved, Ish, Mignat, Kasif, Umar, Tav, Oto, Az, Yakal, Bo. Okay, so this word servant here, okay, is a Strong's number 5650, and it means a bed or bod. Okay, now when we go to, let me clear that out there. The question now here is, this servant in verse 45 is the word shakir, a sair, and it means a hired servant. What I'm trying to share here now is that when you read that verse 45 in Hebrew, it's tushav wa sakir lo yakal bo. Now, this is what's going on. This communion, this marriage ceremony that the Father wants to have with the nation of Israel, is an intimate relationship. And there are prerequisites that the Father is giving in order to have this intimate relationship. You can't do whatever it is that you want to do. It's just not going to happen. Foreigners, okay? These foreigners that's mentioned in 1245, they cannot come into this covenant agreement with the nation of Israel. Any of the covenants that is mentioned from the menorah, first and foremost, it is dedicated for the nation of Israel. Will other people be part of? Can they attend? Yes, but the wedding is for the nation of Israel, my people. And a lot of times that confuses a whole lot of people. And even when it gets to the point where people who are not familiar with the Israelite walk, it is very important that we understand is that in participating in the meal or the festival, you're actually now obligating yourself now to the rules and regulations of the covenant. So this isn't like your regular everyday meal. Even when we see now what was happening at Mount Sinai, remember now, the main instructions that the Father is giving now is that tell this to the children of Israel. Israel, 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 Israel. And we've come so accustomed to not looking at the main character in the story. What we want to do is worry about who's the co-star or who's the man in the movie that's washing the windows. Nobody wants to know about Denzel Washington, who is the main character. Everybody should be focusing on the main character. But Israel has gotten so duped where the main character is not the focal point of the movie or the story here. So I'm not, the scripture is not isolating anybody, but here it is very explicit. And Israel has to learn how to follow the law, the instructions. These foreigners, okay, they were not, take for example, I'll use just one last example. We had Solomon, okay, He would hire servants from all over the place to build his navy and cut lumber and things like that, okay? But they were not allowed to participate in the festivals. Israel, we were servants to one another, but we have the opportunity now to be released from the debt during the Jubilee cycles. So I just want to make sure everybody, again, keeps everything in its proper perspective. But again, at the same time, can certain other nations, and it doesn't get explicit here, we'll talk about this a little bit later, can other people participate? Yes, they can. And the Father gave us instructions where we see with Abraham, where in order for things for everybody to be in one accord with Abraham, Abraham had to circumcise not just himself, but all of his hired servants, his own household. So, but there's a difference again between a foreigner and a servant, and a servant now. Who's not with you? I mean,
you mind if I build on
that?
Because even when you look at the word in verse 44, when it says, "And every slave or servant bought with money, him thou shalt circumcise, and thou shalt eat thereof." This is speaking of a household servant. This is a servant that's living in your house. He was partaking of your customs. He was going to be living with you. Whereas when it talks about in verse 45, a sojourner or a hireling shall not eat thereof, because a sojourner was a nomad. They are passerbys. They come in and out. They go from place to place. And a hireling was just, as Moray was saying, this is a different type of servant. This servant don't belong in the land. They're just doing a service that you paid them for the moment. So these are not the type of people that you give privy access to the things of your household. It's just common sense, because you're employing the enemies.
Exactly.
Now, Maury, you guys did, you did do a class that had, where you guys went into each one of the servants. There's five different, strangers. There's five different strangers, and each one of those strangers have a different, let's say, a different
role
than they can do with the children of Yasharal. So I think there was three of them that couldn't even sit down to eat with us, pretty much. And there was two of them, one of them that would actually live with you, and they had to actually do the customs exactly like you did. And then the other one was basically coming in and out. But there was one of them, he said, you can't even, don't do nothing with them, don't have anything to do with them.
Yeah, but just like Yabe mentioned of Eliezer, I mean, so he was a very important person. You know, he talked about his master and everything like that, how the father had made Abraham real rich and everything like that, and he trusted him so much where he actually gave him the dowries now to give to Isaac's wife, which was Rebecca, and you know, the whole family there. So again, which is, I don't want to get too far into it, but I just wanted to share here now that this is an intimate relationship that the father is trying to have with the nation of Israel. And a lot of times I don't think people like kind of get it. And even with the whole thing, Moray, he's going to talk about this a little bit more, and we're going to discuss more about this whole thing with circumcision and this whole token of faith, because these things are happening in increments, and I'll just leave it there, okay? Because me and Moray, we're going to have to talk about some things here with this whole thing with this circumcision that Abraham was also doing, and circumcision came actually before the Levitical law. So there's a whole lot on that scripture here. But anyway, we're pretty much done, Mishpachah. What verse are you on now? Because we're almost done here, right?
That was 45.
Okay, 45. Let's just kind of finish this up, because everything else is pretty much self-explanatory. And we go ahead and do the lamb, the bitter herbs, and my rendition of unleavened bread.
Okay. In one house shall it be eaten, and ye shall not carry of the flesh out from the house, and a bone of it shall ye not break. All the congregation of the children of Yasharal shall keep it. And if any proselyte shall come to you, you keep the Passover to Yahuwah. Thou shalt circumcise every male of him, and then shall he approach to sacrifice it. And he shall be even as the original inhabitant of the land. No uncircumcised person shall eat of it. They shall be one, there shall be one Lord to the native and to the proselyte coming among you. And the children of Asherah did as Yahuwah commanded Moses and Aaron for them, so they did. And it came to pass in that day that Yahuwah brought out the children of Israel from the land of Egypt with their forces.
Hallelujah. 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 So, Mr. Pekah, again, there's a greater Exodus that's coming up. Okay, we just want to use this as a memorial service. If anybody was to ask why you do the things that you do, how is it that you're the people of the book? The one, those people that came out of Egypt look like you and I. All right, not like Charlton Heston, Queen Elizabeth, and all these people here. No. All right, Moray, okay, Lackey's going to help to understand, you know, geographics, archaeology, yeah. So, some history, about the west coast of Africa. You can't miss, but it's going to take some time and some dedication, and I'm sure that everybody will be caught up to speed eventually, but we are the people of the book. Yes, sir.
I know you say people that came out of Egypt were us, but you know that's we have to make a correction on that.
Uh-huh.
You know, we as people, we have been blindsided.
Uh-huh.
You know, in churches that you know the people like you say they were in Charleston Heston and you know these big other, but there were people like us coming out of Egypt.
Right, so, right. Yes,
there have to be a correction on that part.
Yes.
You know, with some of the churches to understand that.
Yes, that's right, right? Absolutely. Yeah.
That's right.
There have to be a correction made.
Absolutely.
You know, they think it was, you know, people, it was, you know, white that was.
Right.
You can say it, don't worry.
Yes. Absolutely.
You know, we're just talking, you know.
Right, exactly.
But the truth is the truth.
Right, the truth is
the truth.
But in the Bible, it's totally different.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. You know, all nationality that's been reading the Bible, you know.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is white, history,
you know, basically, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Hallelujah. Maura, you have anything you'd like to share before we close the shop?
Man, I just want to say that there was a portion we was reading, and he says when he see the blood, that he will cause the destroyer to pass over. Mm. And I just want to give praise to the Most High, because there's so many times that we really just dismiss the blood of Mashiach.
Yeah. Yes.
And this is the reason why we have not been destroyed. This is the reason why we did not die from different diseases. Mm. This is the reason why COVID passed past us, because it was the blood that caused the destroyer to pass over. Yeah, not your deeds, not your righteousness, not what you look like, not the color of your skin. It was the blood.
Hallelujah.
That's all it was. It wasn't nothing you did. It was the blood. It was mercy. Lord. And these are the things that should lead us into repentance and walking upright before the Most High.
Yes.
I just had to point that out, because sometimes we forget that this is not of our own works. Our works is as filthy rags. Our righteousness is as filthy rags. It is the blood of Mashiach, the lamb that was slain from the beginning. Not ours. His blood was paid. His blood was that atoning sacrifice for us to receive. So that we get the opportunity to praise and worship him and wear white and gold and look like it's because of the blood.
Yes.
We can't take away from that.
Yes, but only the blood.
And it was because of the blood and only his blood. No other blood could do it for us.
No.
Your mother blood, your sister blood, no other, his blood had to do it.
Yeah.
So we have to really remember that. That's imperative to Passover, to the seven feasts. It's imperative that we understand it's because of the blood. It starts and begins and ends with the blood. That's what it is. So I just wanted to point that out.
You have anything you
want
to say?
This was awesome, and this is awesome. And this is the kind of stuff we get every day. I mean, well, lately it has been pretty much every day between Clubhouse and the midweek studies and everything else. But we get this kind of stuff all the time. And I've been in the Christian church for many years, studying to be a minister, a pastor. Not a pastor, but a minister. But I want to say, I don't want to take away from the Christian church, because without the Christian church, we would not be here.
That's right.
Okay? Without the Christian church, we'd have lost everything in slavery. Okay? But at the same token, when the Father gives you more, you live more.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go back and you try to help those who are not. We are people
that have been robbed of everything, from our heritage to even our memory of who we are. Okay? Even the people that are back in the land, a lot of them have been robbed. Okay? So at the end of the day, as the Morris have put out so eloquently, the Father has met us here, just as we prayed earlier. And at the end of the day, our focus and our focus only alone is the Messiah, is the Father. Prepare ourselves for the marriage. As Maury said, don't be caught late. If you are caught late, you know, black people have a tendency to not to get places on time. I'm one of them. At the end of the day, don't be caught late. Because if you caught late, this is over. It's done. Okay? And understand who these strangers, these strangers are. Because if you understand who the strangers are, then you'll understand who the other people around us are. It's only, this is a marriage. It is a marriage with a man and a woman, a bride and a groom. Okay? It's not with everybody else in the neighborhood and all these other nations. It's only one nation. And that's the nation of Yasharah, the nation of Israel. Okay? No other nation. He said the rest of the nation are like spit coming out of my mouth. Okay? That's what the Father has said about the other nations. Now, we don't go bash anybody. We don't dog anybody out. We don't hurt anybody. We don't cheat anybody. We don't kill nobody. We don't do none of that stuff. But we will tell you the truth about who we are. From the Native Americans to the Afro everything, okay? Afro-Asian, Afro-Mexican, Afro-German, Afro-Latino, Afro-Dominican, Afro all that, to those folk who got off the boat, okay? We are one people. One people, okay? One blood, okay? So at the end of the day, I am so glad you guys are able to make it here. This is my home, and I'm happy to have you guys here in this home. And you guys have been faithful throughout the last few years that I've been in the congregation, so I want to thank you for that. But understand what this is about. This is a holy or set-apart day and a holy set-apart meal that we're about to partake in. If your heart is not right, do not take of this meal. Period. Period of that.
Period.
And that being said, with the okay of the mores.
Period. Hallelujah.
Kendrick Yell, you have any words you'd like to share with us? Everybody has a glass here?
Yeah, I'd just like to say, you know, it's been a while for me to, you know, be able to fellowship. I just don't have maybe a proper schedule, but I know I need to definitely try to make more time, so it's definitely a blessing to be here today, because even like my, even my mom was like, you know, I don't really, hear you or see you around, you know, the word as much, and it's definitely, it's been a tough year overall in general. Thankful to be here today and to have life and, you know, to be able to have my little girl here today. She also been able to be with me, so just thankful for a lot of stuff. So.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, you need one more for your Ima. Okay, so Ms. McKay, again, I want to thank everybody for joining us here live. You guys out there on Facebook and everybody here, we gladly appreciate you. We receive you. We pray that we get a chance to see everybody here. Again, the next festival that's coming up is the major one, actually, is Shavuot. And if you can attend that, we would gladly appreciate it. And all that good stuff. But what I'm going to do now is blow the shofar seven times, and we'll have Solomon.
Yes, sir.
Okay, we'll have you to end us with prayer, and we'll go ahead with the rest of the festival from that point going forward.
thank you and praising you, Father, for just meeting us here tonight. You've called us to remember your set-apart Shabbats, Father, and remember these set-apart feast days, Father. And we have come here to partake, fellowship, and to do this as a remembrance of what you did for us in Egypt, Father. I want to thank you, Father, for bringing everyone here safely, letting all of us be here to congregate. Thank you, Father, for placing the word in Maury's hearts to give to us, Father. I pray that you write it upon our hearts, Father, so that we may understand it and internalize it, Father.
Yes.
I thank you for just all the constant blessings, Father, that you give us throughout the day, throughout the week, throughout this year. I thank you, Father, for, you know, as my father said, and as Maury Shellac said, the blood that you shed for us to cover our sins, to restore our covenant with you.
Yes.
Thank you for the blood is what is protecting us, Father. The blood is what's keeping us. And I can't thank you enough. I pray that you never let us forget your face, Father, through everything that we do. And I pray that you always lead us and guide us through every decision that we make, Father.
Yes.
I pray that you let us have a wonderful rest of the feast and partake in it and letting us just remember and be able to communicate what this means. I thank you for all these things in your son's set-apart name. Hallelujah.
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 Will you play the sophomore?
Sure. Yes, you can.